Wilma Mankiller was 10. She and her family were relocated from Cherokee lands in Oklahoma to San Francisco. But it was in San Francisco during the Civil Rights era that she found her voice and a belief in the power to make change.
Ladies and gentlemen, please meet the Cherokee Nation Chief of Chiefs.
The first woman ever elected chief of the Cherokee Nation.
A lot of people told her not to do it.
She had death threats.
I picked up the phone. It was somebody on the other side that was cocking a rifle.
They were fearful of a woman leadership.
She's appeared before congressional committees and met with three presidents.
Mankiller likens her job to the CEO of a large corporation, and she's been credited with revitalizing the Cherokee Nation.
In a just country, she would have been elected president.
I've taken a fair amount of teasing about my name, and I finally got a little tired of it. When a man again teased me about my name, which is Mankiller, he asked me about the origin of it, and I told him it was a nickname and I'd earned it. And
my own personal perspective is that I'm a pretty ordinary person that just happened to be given an opportunity to do extraordinary things in my life. I feel very fortunate that I was born Cherokee, that I was born in a community like that. My whole life has played itself out within a set of reciprocal relationships with my family and with the community and with friends.
Your life changed at the age of 11 when you moved to California. That was traumatic, wasn't it?
It was very bewildering. My parents were thinking it would provide an opportunity for a better life for us to grow up in a modern world. The life that we had anticipated did not turn out the way it had been described to us. Like a lot of other people who grew up in poverty and rural areas, we actually didn't know we were poor until later. Everybody in our community, Cherokee and non-Cherokee, lived in about the same circumstances.
Cherokees were the poorest class of people in northeastern Oklahoma, when once we were the reigning class. There was nobody outside of real Cherokee communities that wanted to be Cherokee.
We had no indoor plumbing, no electricity, no access to any kind of modern amenities. So our world was very isolated and very insulated. And we had a small house and a lot of children, so a lot of our world was outside, which is a wondrous world.
She felt a connection with this land, with this piece of land that I've always belonged to the Mankiller family, and this is where she grew up, and this is where love was. Love was here.
I would say we were economically poor, but not poor in other ways. We were rich in many other ways.
The Cherokees had a government before there was a U.S. government. We had a treaty with Britain even before we had a treaty with the United States or one of the colonies. Our land in the southeast, in Georgia, North Carolina, Tennessee, Alabama, was good land for growing tobacco, good land for growing cotton, and there was gold.
Prior to significant contact with the non-Indian people, the Cherokee women had a very prominent role. There was a very powerful woman that they used to call the beloved woman.
Cherokee people are a matriarchal society. Our clan membership translates to us through our mothers.
The children belong to the women.
The property belonged to the women. The house belonged to the women. And men would come in and they would live in the women's homes, but typically they'd be out hunting. They would come and go. In Cherokee mythology, the sun is female because the sun is always there. Women are always there. The moon was male because, you know, sometimes the moon's there, sometimes it's not. Unfortunately, with colonization, women were viewed as chattel and were owned by men.
It was the advent of European patriarchal culture and religious ideas. The U.S. government ridiculed and made fun of the Cherokee and other matrilineal cultures. They called it a petticoat government because the female elders had to sign the treaties along with male elders.
The federal government once had as their policy to wipe us off the face of the earth. There began to be discussion of removing the entire tribe, our entire tribe, to Indian Territory, what is now the state of Oklahoma. President Jackson, who made his reputation as an Indian fighter, sent out U.S. Army to gather up Cherokee families and take them to stockades where they were held in the southeast. Historians began to refer to that removal as the Trail of Tears. And by the time the last contingent of Cherokees arrived in Indian Territory in the spring of 1839, fully one-fourth of our entire tribe was dead.
And it's just like history continually repeated itself.
Indians remain one of our smallest minorities and one of the poorest. But that may be changing in the shift toward city living as they become the new urban tribe.
Our move to California was part of a relocation program managed by the Bureau of Indian Affairs that was designed to, quote, solve the Indian problem by mainstreaming American Indians.
Relocation was the implementation of the destruction of Native peoples in the United States. The architect of the relocation program was one Dillon Meyer. He was plucked out for his work 15 years before in the relocation of the Americans of Japanese descent. It is interesting to see how this person was specifically chosen to do something that is now considered, you know, really a crime against humanity.
Her family was coerced into coming here with the promise of jobs, with the promise of being able to participate more in the country.
So you see, this experience for the Mankiller family was their Trail of Tears, just like their people, the Cherokee people, were uprooted from their ancestral lands in the southeastern United States.
It was like that relocation. Yes, they weren't going to die, but it was like, as a people, they would be scattered.
They took us on a train in Stillwell, Oklahoma, and ended up in downtown San Francisco in the Tenderloin District. It was completely different than what we were accustomed to. We were accustomed to hearing animals. We'd never seen an elevator, had to be shown how to use a flush toilet. It was like landing on another planet or something.
Oakland is really the end of the line. If you come in, you're poor. And of course, most Indians arriving are poor. You want to find a place with cheap rent. That's always the key element to most incoming populations, is where can I afford to live?
They didn't prepare tribal people at all. They just thought we would sort of somehow fall into the melting pot and everything would be okay.
80% of Indians who went on relocation went back home. It didn't work for them to be in a ghetto in Oakland or San Francisco or Chicago.
It was another ill-advised policy developed by the federal government for Native people. We eventually ended up in a notorious housing project in San Francisco called Hunters Point.
That whole zone of the eastern neighborhoods was essentially a very heavy-duty blue-collar part of town. And if you went down there, you felt threatened.
You want me to tell you about San Francisco? The South is not half as bad as San Francisco.
Growing up in that kind of environment had a profound impact on me and my entire family.
That was the real start of her journey. That's what got her into California, for better or for worse.
She met Hugo Olea, a landed man from Ecuador. When they got married, Wilma thought that was just grand. He was such a gentleman.
They wed, had these two wonderful little girls, Gina and Felicia.
But it didn't take very long before she realized that he was holding her back. He was very controlling by nature, sexist.
San Francisco was a place that people came to transform. It was a magnet for all kinds of activism, for amazing things happening.
They want to go someplace where they can be free, and they come here to reinvent themselves, but also to reinvent everything: politics, music, poetry.
I lived in San Francisco when you could literally go to a park and hear Janis Joplin or Jimi Hendrix. It was that kind of era.
Everybody thought everything was possible, and there was a sense of revolution in the air, which meant political revolution, but also personal and social revolution in a way that was going to change how we live.
A bunch of us Berkeley people were picketing the Ecuadorian embassy because some cowboys had killed 24 Indians and they weren't going to prosecute them. Wilma walks up at noon and says, "Hey, guys, what are you doing?" We said, "We're protesting." So she came and joined us.
I met Dolores Huerta at a Catholic church in San Francisco and Cesar Chavez. The early Black Panthers, when they were providing breakfast to young people and senior citizens programs, what they had in common is they were helping people.
The Black Panthers were working and feeding the people, giving school children breakfasts, and making sure that the streets were safe for people.
The political side of it and the activist side of it was just normal to us, and it was just what she taught us to do.
We actually handed out flyers for the Black Panthers organization in support of whatever their issues were at that time, and I had no clue what that was.
There was a high level of racial tension. In 1966 in Hunters Point, there was a riot that led to the declaration of martial law when the police shot a young Black man in the back as he was running away from a stolen car. They actually brought the National Guard and sent them running through the Hunters Point neighborhood with machine guns on Jeeps.
Poverty without community is very different than poverty in a community where there's a group of people who share a specific geographic space, but also share a common history and a common language and common values and some sense of responsibility for one another.
She knew that she was a Cherokee from the very beginning, but she didn't know anything about the history. She didn't know about tribal sovereignty. She didn't know about termination and how the government broke all those treaties.
I learned a lot from the people I met at the San Francisco Indian Center. Made a lot of very lasting and important friendships there. Native American people were beginning to stand up and advocate for their rights.
And she became upset about the way the U.S. government had treated the Cherokee people and the Lakota people and the Navajo people. She literally became a different kind of person.
And that's where Alcatraz really made a big difference.
A group of students from UC Berkeley and San Francisco State cited a treaty provision which said that unused federal land should revert to the use of Native people. And so they went over and claimed Alcatraz Island and set up a community there, and my whole family got involved in that.
The Native Americans reclaimed this land known as Alcatraz Island in the name of all American Indians by right of discovery.
We will purchase said Alcatraz Island for $24 in glass beads and red cloth, a precedent set by the white man's purchase of a similar island about 300 years ago.
The things we were fighting for when we occupied Alcatraz Island was an end to termination of Indian treaties and an end to the relocation program. And we stayed out there for 19 months.
We want this for our own, for us to build it and make it, either make it last or fall, but we want it to do it on our own. I'm proud of being Indian, and I'm going to stand up to the United States government to prove it.
The violation of Title 18, Section 641, which is theft of government property, that's one instance of the government's non-accessibility to the island in recent months.
I felt in a way that it was somewhat risky. I knew it would be different going there. I made a conscious decision to leave my home and get involved.
The Wilma Mankiller was one of the awesome women that was on Alcatraz. She was probably one of the smartest women that was on there.
Well, first, we want higher education. That is at the university and the state college level.
All of the women on Alcatraz were never given as much credit as they deserve. I think without the women, a lot of stuff would not have happened.
And it was kind of a watershed experience for me. I'd never seen Native people stand up and talk about the need for better health care, better education programs.
It's a stand of self-determination.
Some folks are born made to wave the flag.
There were meetings and discussions, arguing, ceremonies. More than anything, it was like coming home, and I felt that I was where I should be. So when I saw students and Native American people standing up and talking to the international press about these issues, it was somehow liberating for me. And I changed politically after that.
Those are the kind of moments that are sort of unbelievably exciting. They change politics, they change human lives, and they change the course of history. And Alcatraz clearly had that role.
During the occupation of Alcatraz, Nixon signed a bill changing the Termination Act to self-determination. And for the first time in federal government's history, gave land back to Indian people. It was a win, and people saw it as a transformative thing.
Wilma was learning about land rights and tribal sovereignty. She really didn't know about those things when I first met her, when she was a 23-year-old housewife. Pitt River was about reclaiming land that had been taken illegally. So we occupied land that was owned by PG&E. We occupied land that was owned by the federal government.
PG&E had taken our water and had refused to give Indians a dime for it. And that most of our Indians were poor. They had, a lot of them didn't even have electricity. They didn't have hot water. They had outside toilets and all that kind of stuff.
If the jury should find they did not trespass, would this mean they do own that land?
No, of course not. No, that would not be the effect of that at all.
I've been instructed to advise you that the people are in violation in that you are entering and occupying dwellings and real property belonging to the Pacific Gas and Electric Corporation. If you fail to vacate, arrests will occur.
Start arresting these people here.
Start getting these people.
Hey, fellas, start arresting these people. Escort them over. Load them up.
these defendants could not have committed a crime because they sincerely believe it is their land and they have no criminal intent.
Wilma met Aubrey Grossman, who was the attorney for the Pitt River Tribe, and did volunteer work for him for the next several years. She got her education through working for the Pitt River people.
Wilma worked with Pitt River people, with Kashaya Pomo people, to help them maintain and gain their sovereign status, and she knew that was a fight. She learned how hard it was to gain some kind of sovereign status, and she saw what ignorance, neglect, and genocidal policies were.
But it turned out that when she started to become interested in Indian rights, Hugo did not want her to go anywhere. He did not want her to travel. He did not want her to work. He wanted her to be a housewife and raise the two girls. So Wilma finally decided that she had to get a divorce.
Even so it was painful for her, it showed her that pain and suffering is part of growing into a leadership position.
There was never a point in my time in San Francisco, not one point in my life where I ever was not absolutely positive I would return to Oklahoma.
She separated from her husband, took her two daughters, got in a car with, you know, only a little money, drove home to Mankiller Flats.
We came with a U-Haul truck. We had our cat, our dog.
And ultimately, she started a new life.
Coming back here at first, it was hard. The house that they grew up in had been burned down, so there was no place to stay on the land.
At one point, we were living in a tent. Mom couldn't find a job.
I was looking around thinking, there's nothing here.
Living in a car, in a field, by a stream, with very little money, might have been seen by somebody else as a disaster, but to Wilma, it was coming home.
So it was quite a change to come to rural eastern Oklahoma and see that there was a whole different perspective.
Wilma was not really welcome at home when she got there. She'd been gone for almost 20 years. So she had to like start over with those people in the communities.
She had to adapt to the culture that was here among Oklahoma Cherokees.
But she walked into a culture that had become changed from a matriarchal society to mostly a patriarchal society.
She comes back into an American culture that is struggling over the role of women in society. What do you want? This is the age of the ERA, Equal Rights Amendment. This battle is being fought across the country.
Equal rights to have a job, to have respect, to not be viewed as a piece of meat.
I saw other women, women across cultures who were beginning in the 70s to stand up and speak up and assume leadership positions, and they had a profound impact on me.
Wilma came to us when she returned from California fully equipped. She brought back an understanding that change is necessary and it should not be a process to be feared. It should be something to be embraced.
But I can tell you for a fact that nothing was more risky than speaking up in the first meeting where I spoke up. Nothing is riskier than that.
She was determined to let the Cherokee people be on their own without all the bureaucracy of the federal government. And so Wilma was committed to try to bring things about at home for her people when she moved back home.
The only income the tribe had was federal programs. Adair County, where Wilma came from, was actually the second poorest county in all of the United States. It was dismal conditions. So Wilma sort of rolled up her sleeves and started looking at every grant to the contract as possible.
I started writing proposals and developing community projects. And so I caught the attention of the then chief, Ross Swimmer, and he moved me up.
Then she was able to get a job, not easily, but to get a job with the Cherokee Nation. And that began her real authentic life.
She would reach into the non-elected leaders in the community, because those were really true leaders in the community, and she would engage those people to help promote the ideas and buy the ideas or sell the ideas or come up with ideas on their own.
I was the founder and the director of a department called the Community Development Department. I did housing, rural water systems, bilingual education programs, elderly programs.
She looked for those things that would help communities begin to grow and thrive and prosper.
She learned to become the steward of a larger good, of a community good. She had to create something new.
She was in an incredibly horrific car accident. I mean, out on a two-lane road, going over a hill, and head-on crash.
I really thought she might not make it. She was that seriously hurt.
And I recall visiting Wilma in the hospital. She was in bad shape.
The doctor said that she would be in a wheelchair the rest of her life. Then she just wouldn't give up.
And as she's coming out of recovery, she learned that the person in the other car was her very best friend, and she was killed.
She had a little tiny baby, little baby. So I questioned why I lived and she didn't. Seventeen separate operations just so that I could walk again. Then I was recovering from that and I developed systemic myasthenia gravis.
We truly believe that in everything negative, there's something positive there. You just got to see it. That's part of being Cherokee. That's part of being American Indian. And that's part of being a good person and keeping a good mind.
She said, I was no longer afraid of death, but I was also no longer afraid of life. And so I think that was what carried her forward.
If you look at the woman in San Francisco, it was very political, and then look at the person after the accident, I'm much more oriented towards services. So it actually prepared me for what I had to deal with later.
It was probably a couple of years before Wilma did recover from enough, really, to get back to work. And when she said she was ready to go back to work, we were ready to have her come back.
But I think what Wilma saw was the richness of our communities, where people may not have had a lot, but they would share. She'd try to find ways to help people to help themselves. Her Bell Waterline project with Charlie is probably one of the signature ones.
Bell is a small, predominantly Indian community with high unemployment and all the other problems most Indian communities have in America.
It was one of those areas described as one of the poorest in America, and something simply had to be done to bring these people out of poverty.
That sort of triggered the opportunity to go to Bell and suggest to the community that we could do a self-help project. Well, we needed somebody at the tribe then who was willing to learn those principles of self-help and bring the community together and work with us to make it happen. And so I looked to Wilma.
She went to Bell, which was full of mistrust of the nation itself. And the important thing was she asked them what they wanted. Now, she thought maybe they wanted to build a school, but actually what they wanted was to have running water, which they didn't have.
The chief decided to try something, use the limited federal funds to buy the materials for a construction project and let the people of Bell volunteer their labor.
At first, they didn't think it would work.
They couldn't get over the idea that this wasn't going to be done for them.
It was hard times. I don't know, they were just kind of, I guess, separating from each other. You know, the love was not there.
It seemed like there were almost as many obstacles as there were opportunities.
Probably the best thing that resulted from the Bell Project for Wilma Mankiller was Charlie Soap.
Charlie, being Cherokee speaker, he was able to talk to these people. A lot of them were Cherokee speakers.
My role was to go in and help Wilma. And she said, "What do you think, Mr. Soap?" I said, "Well, I don't know. It's going to be hard." She said, "You better change your way of thinking if you want this to be successful." I thought, who is this lady that keeps telling me what to do? And she just walks out, you know?
For quite some time, people didn't want to meet even, but she persisted and just came back until they did. And each
family will. I banked everything I ever believed on that project. Even when people were saying, those people aren't going to show up. Half of them are on welfare. They're going to volunteer to build their own water line in the middle of the summer, in the middle of the winter. And I just knew they would.
Things just started rolling. And you did, yes, you did in the ditch. But you didn't mind.
Every obstacle that was put in our way, I countered it aggressively.
Wilma made it happen. She'd get in there and do what needs to be done. She brought the communities back together.
Women and kids and old men digging trenches, the fact that they could do it themselves and that Wilma had faith in them made the major difference.
Reintroducing the concept of hope and the concept of self-determination, not just at the nation level, but at the community level, bringing families and communities together.
The revitalization of the Bell community was a metaphor for the revitalization of tribal governments.
That was kind of a new beginning for Wilma. Of course, it also gave me a reason in 1983 in the election when I needed a deputy chief to invite Wilma to be on the ticket with me.
She told me that Ross had asked her to run for office. She said, "Do you think I should?" I said, "I don't know." I said, "Wilma," I said, I'm not into politics. So we were in Kenwood, another poor community. We went to this one person's home. One family, his name was Homer Sack.
Did I ask
Who, me?
Yeah, you.
There was a young man, and he was handicapped. And Homer's about in the 70s, an old elder. And Homer said, "I'll be back in a minute." And he picked that boy up, and he carried that boy to the outhouse. And I noticed Wilma got up and went and looked out the window. After we left there, and we were driving down the road, and I noticed she was crying. She said, "Charlie, there's no reason why anybody should be living that way, this way, in this day and age." She said, "By God, I'm going to run for deputy."
Mr. Swimmer is a Republican. I'm a Democrat. And he said, "You're honest with money and you're dedicated to the people." He said, "Those two things are the most important to me." And that was it.
The general reaction was that I had lost my mind.
a lot of the people who supported him, who were on his ticket and worked in his campaign, did not support me. So it was a difficult election.
A tremendous amount of opposition. I even heard it from a distance, that there's this woman over there that is running for office, and how could she? You know, we can't let that happen.
She was at a meeting, and one man came up to her, and he said, "The Cherokee Nation will be the laughing stock of all tribes."
Ross Swimmer had his house shot into.
Late at night, I had a call. Caller said, "This goes to show how bad your judgment is. Wilma Mankiller is down in a bar in Stillwell, Oklahoma, and drunk out of her mind." That was ridiculous. It was a close election. I won by 50.4% of the vote.
It's amazing to me that she went home in 77, and by 83, she was the second leader of the Cherokee Nation. Just doesn't happen.
And I had been asked a couple of times to come to Washington and head the Bureau of Indian Affairs. In 85, I agreed. So first thing I did was talk to Wilma.
So Ross is asking everybody about, "I need you people to pray for me. I just, last night President Reagan appointed me Undersecretary of the Interior, and Wilma's now your chief." And I always thought that was funny that Reagan made Wilma the chief.
Wilma Mankiller is set to become the first woman ever to serve as the tribe's principal chief.
The difficult part was that I inherited Ross Swimmer's staff, and many had not supported me. It was a very difficult balancing act. And I learned somewhere in my life that in solving problems and dealing with political adversaries, try to do it in the least divisive way possible.
Wilma and I worked together for a couple of years, and then I started saying, you know, I could tell there was some electricity going on between us. And so I asked her, I said, "Wilma, you want to go see a movie? You want to go see Rambo?" She said, "Rambo? I hate Rambo." I thought, oops. And so I drove to Tulsa and pulled into a Coney Island hot dog place. She said, "What are we doing here?" I said, "We're going to eat." She said, "Here?" I said, "Yeah." She said, "I hate hot dogs." I said, "Oh my God, I struck out here." Man, I love those hot dogs.
She was comfortable with Charlie because Charlie was comfortable with himself. He's just exactly the opposite of a macho Ecuadorian prince. They married in 1986, and the two of them together was a potent duo. I've never known a better pairing.
He's very gentle, and he's way more spiritual than I am.
I was honored to have someone like Wilma in my life. She had so much love for people. She had such a big heart.
Has your manhood ever been threatened by the fact that Wilma's chief of the Cherokee Nation?
No, it really hasn't, because it doesn't bother me one bit.
All right, right.
We were doing some construction work projects, like water lines, and one time Wilma came in and she said, "Do you realize you have all women in your department?" I had a lady that could run a dozer, that could use dynamite, and that could use a jackhammer and drive a dump truck. So it was just nothing because the way I was brought up, brother, sister, mom, and dad, we all worked together.
Okay. I served from 85 to 87, and then in 1987, I ran for election on my own. It was the very first time I'd ever faced overt sexism. In fact, I think the phrase was, I didn't have a snowball's chance in hell of winning.
People would say, The other tribe is going to really laugh at us, put us down because of a woman being our leader.
They feared ridicule. They feared being condescended to.
Sexism is like racism. It's very dehumanizing. It became very hurtful to campaign.
She had death threats. She had people calling her on the phone and calling her names. She had stuff poured in her gas tank. Her tires were slashed.
People got mean. And the meaner they got, the harder we fought.
This is where she had to remember the trials and tribulations that her people had been through forever. She turned to that for solace, and she turned to that for wisdom, and she prevailed.
The issue, at least within the Cherokee Nation, of whether leadership has anything to do with gender or whether gender has anything to do with leadership is settled. I have to say, I think we might be a little bit ahead of the rest of the country with regard to that.
I, Wilma P. Mankiller,
do solemnly swear or affirm.
It was very rare and very wonderful to have a woman as the principal chief of my tribe. It was one of the most exciting times.
Preserve, protect, and defend
the constitutions of the Cherokee Nation.
The constitutions of the Cherokee Nation.
And the United States of America.
And the United States of America.
I swear or affirm further.
I swear or affirm further.
That I will do everything within my power.
That I will do everything within my power.
To promote the culture.
To promote the culture.
Heritage and traditions.
Heritage and traditions.
Of the Cherokee Nation.
Of the Cherokee Nation.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
I've always seen inaugurations as moments to define an administration. It was just a majestic moment that, for us, was the expression of promise where the nation can and should go.
There are powerful anti-Indian lobbyists who are constantly trying to diminish tribal rights, and I think that what we have to do is we have to stay constantly on top of that situation to protect our tribal rights.
She dared to advance the concept that you can be in control of your future.
Thank you very much.
She's the right person at the right time.
What was the first reaction when you became chief?
Terror.
I thought people would want to talk about ideas and what I wanted to do, or they'd look at some of the things I'd already accomplished. But a lot of them wanted to talk about whether or not we should have a woman, you know, leading the Cherokee Nation. That was very difficult.
She spends a little too much time somewhere else and too much on women's lib, which she should be spending here with the nation.
Sometimes the delegation's very happy to see me and they're smiling until I tell them what I'm there for, and then they stop smiling, but no one's out and out said, "No, we cannot do this, Wilma, dream on."
One time she said, "I've been told by several men that I'm wasting my time trying to promote women in management because they're not really going to be probably better than average. Don't expect any more than that." And she said, "Well, we've been putting up with average men managers for decades, so I don't know what it would hurt."
Mankiller is an old Indian name. It means warrior. Wilma Mankiller is indeed a fighter.
So I've done everything I could do to make everybody in the world mad at me this last 4 years. I don't beat around the bush.
Wilma and I are so far apart politically, it's not even humorous. I'm very conservative, and Wilma is very liberal, but I always supported her.
From a political perspective, she was able to start off with a clean slate, did not have to embrace allegiance to Democrats or Republicans.
And when I saw her at work, there was never any assumptions about her gender. She was there as a Cherokee doing her work.
Of course, the mayor's election in Stillwell is compared to what we do
with
the Cherokee Nation.
Chief Mankiller had been lobbying Congress to get a new health care facility in Salisaw and one in Stillwell.
The clinic in Stillwell was only a small room in the back of the store that's only open a few days a week for one of the populations that has some of the highest mortality and morbidity rates in the whole country. I mean, it was just unthinkable.
What I've asked several people in Stillwell to do I guess a couple of years ago, is look for a way for us to build a new clinic next to the Stillwell Hospital so that we could figure out some way to share more resources.
I thought this meeting was to expose you all to other sites than the hospital so that the city could have input.
Being the first and trying to be innovative, there are always obstacles and challenges. You know, a lot of people want to set back and wait for other people to do something. That was not Chief Mankiller.
I understood that we were going to see if there were any other factors that could make the Stillwell Hospital site doable.
We were always in the spotlight trying to lay that foundation. It has ultimately led to the Cherokee Nation having the largest tribal health care system in the United States. We started college scholarship programs, training programs for medical coding, for dental assistants. We have Cherokee physicians working in our system, Cherokee nurses, Cherokee dentists, Cherokee psychologists, because we wanted our Cherokee people taking care of our Cherokee people too.
But critics still claim the chief hasn't done enough for economic development. They say business takes a back seat to the chief's social programs, like this $6 million youth job center.
I have a different way of viewing economic development. I think that economic development doesn't exist in a vacuum. In order to have good economic development, you have to emphasize education and have a good educated populace. You have to have well people.
Ka.
Ka.
Ha.
Ha.
Ga.
Ga.
She turned the telescope around. Previous leadership had viewed the Cherokee Nation from the principal chief's office out toward the people. Wilma looked through the other end of that telescope and viewed the Cherokee Nation from the perspective of the people.
The triumph of community. She saw the power of community to help each other. I think that even the people who were adamantly against her when she became principal chief had to grudgingly acknowledge the things that she accomplished.
She brought back and reawakened Cherokee concepts that are as inextricable as our clan structure or our language, simply brought it into a modern era and set it into motion once again.
Nice to meet you, Angel. Nice to meet you, Charles.
The most important thing was to trust yourselves. And she wanted young girls and young men to think in terms of leadership, that if they want to get things done in their life, don't be afraid to step up. Step up and take on the role of being a leader.
Hi, how are you? Nice to see you.
I'm well pleased to present the chief of the Cherokee Nation who is running for re-election, Wilma Mankiller, the chief of the Cherokee Nation.
Thank you. I know you have a lot of important business here today, so I won't take up much of your time. I've been concerned about and interested in improved relationships between the Indian tribes and the state of Oklahoma. We've got to figure out some way to work collaboratively.
Wilma's presence outside of the Cherokee country was just phenomenal. She was so relaxed. She was the chief, and she projected herself as chief. People respected her. They knew what she was doing and what she was trying to do. And it wasn't just in Oklahoma. We went to Japan, Taiwan, Washington, D.C.
Wilma?
Thank you very much for inviting me. For several hundred years, the United States government has been trying to figure out what to do with the, quote, Indian problem, unquote. And basically, we have some ideas about how to do that ourselves. Unemployment on Indian reservations is around 54%. During the Great Depression, unemployment in this nation was between 20 and 30%, so it's a significant problem. And with that in mind, there are some specific things that I'd like to recommend. Investment tax credits and wage credits for private investors in Indian country.
Self-governance. She would provide the vision. She would provide the force leadership behind that.
Mortgage revenue bonds so that we could build our own houses.
She was a historical thinker, and she knew that the tribe prospered more when the federal government was not trying to control our tribe.
It's always been a struggle to maintain tribal sovereignty. We're under siege. I tell you, it's going to take a fight.
But self-determination wasn't just a cue the balloons type of an event. There were factions within the Cherokee Nation that took a worrisome view towards self-determination. Because if you're going to be in charge of your own government, you'll have to be in charge of your own government. Wilma saw that. It wasn't just about freeing the Cherokee Nation from the bureaucratic yoke of the federal government.
Hi, Mr. Miller asked if I'd come by today and just kind of give you a brief update on what's going on at the Cherokee Nation.
It was about returning a freedom to the Cherokee people to decide where the Cherokee Nation was going to go in the next century.
I mean, it was an exciting time. I mean, we were doing all kinds of things, redesigning our programs and operations. It was just progress in motion. Things were happening that had been held back for over a century.
We entered into that self-governance agreement in 1990. That was quite historic. And Wilma signed that actually from her hospital bed.
Mankiller's doctor here at New England Deaconess Hospital says that 50% of transplantation patients will experience rejection in the first 30 days.
10 days ago, she underwent a kidney transplant.
It's the waiting part of it. Is everything going to go fine? Is the kidney going to keep functioning? And how's she doing? And is she in a lot of pain or and that kind of thing is what's going through my mind.
She had very serious illnesses. She had a couple of disease processes that were very serious.
I've had the same health issues that Mom's had, kidney failure, kidney transplant. In 1997, I was diagnosed with a brain tumor. I mushroomed myself into a corner. I was very upset, had not had any health issues whatsoever. Mom said, you need to give yourself a day to mourn what is happening. Okay, do whatever you want to scream. If you want to throw things. And then what you need to do is you need to get your team of people together, your family, and you need to figure out how you're going to fix it. And that's what helps you get up off your butt and be functional every day. And I learned that from Mom.
Sound too existential, but power of character supersedes frailty of mortal coil.
She not only came to work, she sat in the meetings with us. She saw herself in a frame of time, in this place and time, and she just had so much time, whatever it is, I think she thought it was limited, and she needed to get these things done while she had the ability to do it. And as long as she could get up and go, she felt like she had the ability to do that.
Finally tonight, our person of the week. She's a person who's made
Chief
a remarkable
Wilma Mankiller and the Cherokee Nation of Oklahoma. Hello!
Hello!
I think some of the tribal members were jealous of Wilma.
She is now the leader of her great people.
She was doing so many things for the Cherokee tribe and for the Cherokee people. And they saw her getting too many accolades and getting too powerful.
This is Chief Mankiller. I wish my opponents had the courage of our Cherokee ancestors and would look me directly in the eye and deal with the issues as I have dealt
with. Tribal politics is much, much different than white man politics. It's not just something that occurred during Wilma's term as chief. It started back in the before Cherokees ever came to Oklahoma. There was a division of the tribe.
Chief, how are you? I'm so glad to see you today. Everybody say cheese.
All right. The other day they said, I could blackmail you. I have a picture of you sitting on the front of a car with a Coors something at a 49. And I said, you couldn't blackmail me. Everything I've ever done, they told in 1983. Yeah. And more. Stuff I wish I'd done.
Right. 80%, after everybody said she couldn't get elected, she got 80% of the vote.
Whether you sought it or not, I think a lot of people view you as a feminist.
Yes. Oh, no, I absolutely identify myself as a feminist.
And you've not walked away from that?
Oh,
you
not at all.
You have gladly accepted that responsibility?
No, if you look up the definition of a feminist is someone who advocates for the role of women, and I am absolutely, totally, 100% an advocate for women defining for themselves what it means to be a woman and doing anything they want to do.
Wilma took me in her office one day. She said, you could be more beneficial to the tribe if you want to come back after going and getting broader experiences. And she told me that she saw me working in D.C. Those skill sets, everything that I learned from her in those early days, and to feel confident that what I'm saying mattered and to have dialogue, she created that foundation for me that has paid off remarkably in my career.
She was a big supporter of women, regardless of whether they were Native American or not Native American. And she was down to earth and friendly and generous with her time.
We awarded Wilma Ms. Magazine Woman of the Year prize, which seemed the world's most obvious thing to do. We were honored that she accepted it in a just country. She would have been elected president.
Wilma, maybe the first definition of indigenous feminism, the difference in individual self-determination and collective self-determination. And she really defined that beautifully.
She said, I believe that unless we develop and embrace our own economic sovereignty, that we will be singularly dependent upon what the federal government provides for us.
The decision to go into gaming for the Cherokee tribe was gut-wrenching. Other tribes had had good success, but she didn't want to be the chief who used gambling as a road to prosperity.
We didn't go for gambling. We preached against it. So we were totally against it.
Anti-gaming sentiment from church groups, also from her political rivals within the Cherokee Nation. She was dealing with literally a Rubik's Cube of issues.
Gambling is about greed, get-rich-quick scams. It's not about saving your money and working hard.
Well, they gave us opportunity so that the Native American can have jobs and gave us, opened the doors for that.
Gaming is doing for the tribes and its people what the federal government has failed to do.
People resisted seeing tribes become successful, to see that we could actually expand, that we could build one of the best schools in the whole area, that we have all these people spending their recreational dollars in our communities.
She said, it came to me in the night. I see the tremendous needs that we have in housing, the unemployment we have. And she said, I know that gaming would provide us the money to help address a lot of those needs.
Probably one of the greatest skill sets that Wilma Mankiller possessed was that she was a great listener. And she listened to her opponents, she listened to people that were in favor of her ideas, she listened to those that were independent third parties. She would seek opinions from a 360-degree environment that would allow her to make the best possible decision.
Wilma pushed for and got Bingo. And it created hundreds of jobs.
Bingo on 066.
We grew it into gaming. We've added 5,000 jobs in gaming. We grew our health care system from $30 million of expenditures to $330 million of expenditures.
Finally, everything started working and everybody realized that hospitalization and education even though they didn't still agree with it, but it was something that was accepted at that time.
Cherokee Nation broke ground recently on an expansion project for the Wilma P. Mankiller Health Center in Stillwell. This is the fourth of five healthcare infrastructure projects to be paid for with Cherokee Nation casino profits.
We game in 28 states, 250 tribes. This is a $30 billion industry. 679,000 jobs in our industry, and approximately half are folks from outside our community.
Wilma Mankiller has tackled some tough issues as chief of the Cherokee Nation, but none so tough as the decision to run again for office. The chief consulted her pastor and a Cherokee medicine man before making the decision.
She pulled me to the side and she was saying, what do you think? And I said, I can't tell you, I can't make that decision for you.
We also need to remember that Wilma suffered a lot physically. She was very, very, very ill, and she handled that with such grace.
She was coming to Ms. Foundation board meetings, and she was clearly not very well.
We were sitting at the table, and just out of nowhere, she said, Charlie, I'm not going to run again for next term. And I said, why not? I said, Wilma, you're doing good. People like you. You're doing a lot of positive things for the nation. She just looked at me and she said, well, I just found out that I have cancer. I said, oh my God.
Her mobility was becoming limited, but she had set time aside for like 2 hours just for employees to come and, you know, say their farewells and wish her well. That 2 hour period turned into almost 2 days. But the feeling among the employees was a feelings of fear, like we're losing our leader. What's going to happen now?
So the crisis really began with the election in 1995. In the summer of 96, the tribal council began having trouble getting reports, financial information that they needed on the operation of the tribal government and tribal businesses.
I was given information that there was a possible misuse of tribal and federal program funds.
Tribal prosecutor asked the administration to turn over certain documents voluntarily, and they refused. The chief marshal, Pat Ragsdale, served the warrant, and he was in the process of searching when the chief literally walked in, and there was a big confrontation.
Shortly after that, the administration attempted to fire myself and the rest of the marshals. The court stepped in and told us to stay in place. And I got a call about 4 o'clock in the morning, and I was told by the marshals that were at the courthouse that the courthouse had been invaded by the security force.
A number of people found that repulsive, including Chief Mankiller.
She had done a lot to improve the lot of the Cherokee Nation and Cherokee Nation governance. And here, in less than 2 years, she was seeing it all fall apart.
It was starting to get very ugly and violent. Chad Smith was wrestled to the ground.
There were police helicopters overhead. There were snipers on top of buildings.
At the same time that everything was starting to unravel at the Nation, Wilma was battling lymphoma.
She was watching all this. She had already left politics. She had no obligation to take action. But I think she felt a moral obligation and compulsion to do something because it was breaking her heart.
She heard what was going on at the tribal council, and she says, I'm going to go down there. I remember driving my police car to Tahlequah, praying that we didn't do anything to get anybody killed. We were confronted immediately by supporters of the administration. They were jeering at us, throwing insults at her, and worse.
She had to take some action. She had to do something.
Dear President Clinton, during the past 4 months, the Cherokee Nation has been engaged in an increasingly tense struggle to maintain a constitutional tribal government.
The people are furious. Though we have lost our way a lot, we have fought for and maintained a democratic form of government.
There were times during the past 4 years, the Bureau of Indian Affairs became involved and deepened the crisis dramatically.
Yet we persevered,
Bruce Babbitt,
and a number of
Interior Secretary,
honest,
and to Janet
qualified
Reno.
People are working day and night.
Sincerely, Wilma P. Mankiller.
The Joe Byrd administration sued Wilma for fiscal malfeasance, which is laughable.
That suit didn't have any merit. And it wasn't going to go anywhere in our court system. So, I mean, it was a way to harass Wilma.
It was as sick as I've seen her. And in that condition, she was being followed by armed thugs.
Wilma never wavered. Quite remarkable, the courage and the character that she displayed.
If we look at all those who have been awarded the Medal of Freedom, their lives and contributions make up some of the most important chapters of the American story. The story of a nation struggling to end the plague of discrimination. The story of Americans working to preserve our culture and our environment.
During her 2 terms in office, and I might add she won re-election by 82%, she was not only the guardian of the centuries-old Cherokee heritage, but a revered leader who built a brighter and healthier future for her nation.
I really didn't realize until I got older the impact Mom had on not just the Indian people, but the world.
I don't think we've produced another tribal leader that nationally was more significant and more visible. She kind of made you proud to be Native American. She made you proud to be Cherokee because something special was happening.
She was not out looking to knock someone else down. She was looking to move forward the common good. And I think everyone in politics would do well to kind of carry some of Wilma's spirit with them today.
She had a depth of seeing through to your heart, seeing through to your purpose, seeing through to your character. She had clarity.
Sometimes I think those of us who have lost our tribe have a cellular memory of what once was. Wilma was so authentic and true to herself that she made us feel at home where we had never been. We were planning together and had begun somewhat of a book, and actually we were going to spend May together at her kitchen table when I got a call in March saying, come now, and then of course I realized what that meant.
She was in a lot of pain. And then finally, they told her that she had pancreatic cancer. And the doctor said, well, I think you need to start chemo right away. She said, why? She said, you're just gonna prolong my pain, my suffering. She said, I've done what I did I'm supposed to do on this earth, and I'm gonna go on.
Has just been to be here for a tiny, tiny period of time in the totality of history. And I guess I don't think I leave any great legacy. I hope that if when I leave, that it'll just be said I did what I could. Thank you.
After all is said and done, what will be your legacy? Our life.